What is Russia's attitude about Sestanovich?
Very negative, because we think that he is not credible. Well, first of all, he has launched this crazy military adventure against South Ossetia, and we think it's an act of genocide and ethnic cleansing. By the way, have you heard how what the code name of the operation was? The code name apparently was Clean Field. Very telling in terms of trying to clean people out of South Ossetia. And then over the years, we have had a very bad experience talking.
As in cleaning, as in ethnic cleaning?
As in ethnic cleansing, exactly. Yeah. Clean Field was the code name of the operation. From the Georgian side. It was when they moved into Ossetia, overrunning our and shooting at our peacekeepers and killing civilians, over 2,000 civilians, creating massive flow of refugees to Russia. Out of 120,000 or so population of South Ossetia, over 30,000 found themselves in the Russian territory, even though it's rather difficult to make it from South Ossetia to Russia because of the one tunnel which is connecting the territory of South Ossetia with North Ossetia, which is in Russia. So we think that he has done something horrible, something which is worthy of the International Criminal Court in The Hague. But this is a thing which...
He's a war criminal?
We think that there are some good grounds to look into it very carefully. But on the other hand, we have had a very negative experience to him with him over the years, because...
Is that because he's a darling of the West and because America supports him so much and because he was educated in America because he was...
You know, our presidents, I can assure you, have had more meetings with him than President Bush and Secretary Rice combined. You know, we've been talking with him. President Medvedev has had a couple of meetings with him. One thing we've been telling him from the outset when he came to power, I think in 2004, don't use military force against Abkhazia and South Ossetia. And he was swearing to us and everybody else that he could not even contemplate that because he said, I cannot use force against my own people.
It is fair, because you said it on this program, you're not happy with Georgia becoming part of NATO or the Ukraine becoming part of NATO. That's an established Russian position articulated by you on this show.
It is.
He's very much in favor of NATO.
It doesn't have anything to do with our response to his military adventure in South Ossetia.
But some say you went much further than was necessary. You could have had a response, but you didn't have to go as far. You went beyond...
We didn't do two things. We didn't target civilians. But what we did do, we also took care of some infrastructure which was supporting their military operation against South Ossetia.
Yeah, but you also bombed the pipelines, did you not?
No, we did not.
There's no bombing of the pipelines.
There was no bombing of the pipelines. In fact, there may have been some misunderstanding, because at the same time reports were coming about some fire on the pipeline, but it was on the Turkish territory actually.
Because some will argue that this is about regime change. This is a Russian effort to change the regime in Georgia.
Because they want
somebody a little bit more open to the Russian positions.
You know, we are not about changing regimes. Some other countries have invented this thing, you know, removing people, putting people in office and in palaces. We don't do that. But we make no secret of the fact that we really believe that... Should Mr. Saakashvili step down, it will help everybody. It will help Georgia.
Is it a demand of Russia?
No, it's...
Will it be a demand of Russia?
We are just saying that we are not going to have any dealings with him personally. Of course, that does not mean...
But how can we get this settled if you're not going to have any dealings with him personally?
We are not going to talk to him. We regard him
but that's
as...
that's by definition, isn't it? I mean,
not necessarily. And, you know, why are you...
So how will we have any kind of agreement if you're not willing to talk to the man who's been elected president of the country?
You know, there is a possible indictment of the president of Sudan, for instance, and the United States is saying, well, we should not hesitate because no impunity is our high moral principle. And for some reason, with this particular guy, the United States is doing to shield him, and as if he were a naughty child or something. Okay. In her conversations with our foreign minister, Secretary Rice kept saying, please do not use the term ethnic cleansing. Please do not use the term genocide.
Well, the intent is really to take a pro-Western, aspiring democracy, Georgia, which was on the border of Russia, and bring it under Russian control to reestablish an old hegemonic control over Georgia. And I think that that is the military mission. It has been all along. It's not really about... South Ossetia, it's really about getting rid of a pro-Western government on their border. What we should do about it, I think that the international community, at the very least, needs to make it clear that there are very serious long-term consequences to this kind of Russian behavior, and that what Russia has enjoyed, which is a tremendously high degree of international standing and membership in a lot of institutions, it's going to lose those positions in the world as a result of this action.
And so the response should be what?
Well, a lot of times, you know, the response isn't directly to deal with the state that is the disturber. You know, when the Berlin Wall went up, nobody did anything but against the Soviets. But there was a realization that they're dealing with a new kind of policy. You know, in this case, there are a number of areas where the U.S. and Europe have acted as though they didn't need to have a common policy. I'd give you one example that is sort of lurking in the background of this story, and that's energy. The United States and Europe do not have a common policy toward the emergence of Russia as an energy superpower. It's no longer possible to do that. And I think the first thing that the U.S. needs to do is sit down with its allies and say, okay, we're in a whole new world now. It can't do that at the United Nations Security Council. It can have some amusing diplomatic repartee between our representative and theirs, in which they call each other names the way Adlai Stevenson and the Soviet ambassador did during the Cuban Missile Crisis. But really, you're not going to get any results except in forums where the United States is dealing with like-minded countries that are seeing this as a problem. That means don't expect anything to come out of the United Nations.
What if all the response to Russia doesn't work?
The consequences of acting are, you know, going to depend a lot on whether the United States and its allies can restore some credibility for their policies. I mean, I'll give you another example. A lot of other post-Soviet states on the Russian periphery are watching to see whether there's any kind of coherence in the Western response. So far, most other states have hunkered down and have made clear they're not going to cross Russia, so that the Kazakhs and the Azeris, for example, are not pumping oil through Georgia, which is how they've gotten some of their oil to international markets. There's only one state that has, among the former Soviet states, that has defied or even raised a hint that it might object to what the Russians are doing. That's Ukraine. And having a policy that says to the Ukrainians, we know you're disturbed about what has happened. We want to talk seriously about the kind of relationship that we're going to have with you. That'll be an important part of what we do. We need the United States and its allies need a diplomatic strategy that looks beyond this immediate crisis. You know, trying to get a ceasefire is really going to be successful only if the Russians have decided they want a ceasefire, so that the president of France today was told not to come to Moscow because they don't want to sign a ceasefire. Same with the French foreign minister. But there are other things that we can do that don't depend entirely on Russian acquiescence. And that's the kind of policy deliberations that need to be taken right now. The Russians are not going to be acquiescing in much. They've decided what they're going to do, and it may be pretty ugly.
But, I mean, one thing that we can do, and I don't want to underestimate this, is we can start making it clear what exactly, in the largest terms, the price for Russia's position on the international scene is going to be. This may not have an immediate effect on them, but we can't rule it out either. I mean, as long as there is division and dithering, Russia's paying no price. But if we do start talking about what their position is in the G8, what their relationship is with the EU, for instance, they're supposed to be negotiating an EU strategic partnership. If that is going to be suspended, if the NATO-Russia relationship is going to be suspended, if people start talking about possible economic sanctions against Russia, Russia needs to know that there will be a price. Right now, they don't feel there's going to be any price, and therefore it's hard to judge what their reaction would be if they did think there was going to be a price.
Join us online at charlierose.com.